Forget dusty digs and forgotten caves. The latest earthquake in human origins comes from the most unexpected place, the seabed. Industrial dredgers looking for ordinary sand have pulled our ancient relatives from a lost, drowned world. Homo erectus, found in Sunken, Sundaland. This isn't just another fossil. It's a bombshell that could rewrite everything. This lost world was Sundaland, a vast landmass in Southeast Asia, now silent beneath the waves, a casualty of the last ice age when the seas rose. But that silence has just been shattered. From this drowned realm, a truly groundbreaking discovery has surfaced, forcing us to rip up the early chapters of human history and start again. What did they find? Homo erectus fossils, the first ever from these submerged lowlands. And it's not just a couple of bones. We're talking a treasure trove of evidence dredged up right off the coast of Java in a place called the Madura Strait. This isn't just another fossil find. It's like finding a key to a locked room in our own ancient family home, a room we didn't even know existed. So how do you find ancient human ancestors at the bottom of a busy shipping channel? You don't. It finds you. Between 2014 and 2015, massive industrial marine sand dredging operations near Surabaya were just, well, digging up sand. For construction, probably. And in doing so, they accidentally stumbled upon an ancient submerged river valley, part of the old Solo River system. Yes, that's Solo River, famous for other Homo erectus finds like Trinol and Ngandong. But this was new. This was underwater. This changes the game. The dredging brought up over 6,000 fossil remains. Among them, two precious cranial fragments, parts of a skull, enough to identify Homo erectus. We're talking bits of the forehead, including that classic heavy brow ridge and part of the main skull. What's fascinating is one fragment looks a lot like the Samba Machan III skull, another relatively late Homo erectus from Java. A family resemblance, perhaps, across millennia? These precious relics are now housed at the Geological Museum in Bandung, Indonesia, thanks to an incredible international team effort from Indonesia, the Netherlands, Germany, Australia, and Japan. The news, including a lecture at Leiden University, just hit the public consciousness around May 2025. Now, how old are these sunken secrets? Scientists used a clever technique called optically stimulated luminescence, OSL for short, on quartz grains from the sediment layers. Think of it like this. Sunlight resets a clock in these grains. Once buried, they start absorbing natural radiation, trapping electrons. The longer they're buried, the more energy they store. In the lab, light makes them release this energy as luminescence, and the brightness tells you how long they've been in the dark. Ingenious, right? This dated the sediments to between roughly 163,000 and 119,000 years ago. And our Homo erectus? They were living there approximately 140,000 years ago. 140,000 years ago. That plants them squarely in marine isotope stage 6, MIS-6. What does that mean? Think of it as Earth's deep freeze, a major glacial period. So much water was locked up in colossal ice sheets that global sea levels were dramatically lower, maybe 30 meters, perhaps even down to an astonishing 120 meters lower than today. And that is why this matters. Lower sea levels meant the Madura Strait wasn't a strait at all. It was dry land, part of the massive Sundaland subcontinent, Java, Sumatra, Borneo, the Malay Peninsula, all connected, stitched directly to mainland Asia. These Homo erectus weren't hardy island castaways. They were inhabitants of a vast continental ecosystem. The land area we see in Southeast Asia today, that's maybe only half of what Sundaland was at its peak. Imagine double the land. And what a land it was. The fossils paint a picture of a savanna-like lowland crisscrossed by rivers. It was a veritable Noah's Ark. Elephants, both modern types and the older stegodon, rhinoceroses, hippopotamuses, ancient cattle like the extinct Bos palaeus indicus, deer, and even macaques. Reptiles, oh yeah, turtles, crocodiles, pythons, and remarkably, Komodo dragons. On Java, and get this, teeth from the Ganges river sharks. This points to a freshwater or brackish estuarine environment, teeming with life. This wasn't some marginal wasteland, it was prime real estate. So our ancestors weren't just surviving here, they were thriving. How do we know? The animal bones tell a story. Researchers found definite cut marks on turtle bones and a bovid jaw, clear signs of butchery, using tools to process carcasses. Even more telling, numerous long bones from those ancient cattle were broken in a very specific, patterned way. Why? To get at the rich marrow inside. This wasn't just scavenging leftovers. This suggests systematic hunting of healthy adult animals and then efficiently using the entire carcass. That's planning. That's skill. This level of resourcefulness, this sophisticated behavior, challenges the old image of Homo erectus as having a simple, limited existence. These were capable, adaptable people. This discovery shatters the idea that Javan Homo erectus was isolated for long periods. During MIAS-6, they were part of a much larger, interconnected world. The ice ages acted like a cosmic on-off switch for land bridges. Cold period? Land emerges, pathways open. Warm period? Seas rise, land submerge. Populations might get separated. And those ancient rivers, like the Solo, they were highways allowing Homo erectus to move, follow game, and access resources across this enormous territory. Which brings us to a tantalizing question. If they could move across this vast connected Sundaland around 140,000 years ago, who else was out there? Could they have met other hominin groups? We know other archaic humans were in Asia then, most notably the Denisovans. The Denisovans, known from Siberia, Tibet, maybe elsewhere. With Sundaland acting as this huge land bridge, the chances of these different groups bumping into each other, or at least occupying neighboring territories, suddenly becomes much more plausible. Do we have proof of a Pleistocene meet and greet? Not yet. No hybrid fossils, no shared, unique tool types. Yet. But the possibility, it's hanging in the air. Electric. Some of the sophisticated hunting and processing behaviors we see in the Madura Strait finds even echo behaviors often linked with later archaic humans on the Asian mainland from around the same time. Coincidence? Independent invention? Or contact? This find isn't just about Homo erectus. It's a wake-up call. It screams that submerged prehistoric landscapes are an untapped frontier. For so long, we've looked for our history on dry land, but sea levels have gone up and down like a yo-yo. Huge areas, once prime hominin real estate, are now underwater. The Madura Strait, Doggerland in the North Sea, finds off Taiwan and South Africa. These are just whispers of what might be hidden. With advances in marine survey technology and precise dating, we're getting better at peering beneath the waves. Climate change, ironically, played a double role here. The big freeze of MIS-6 dropped sea levels, creating this habitat. Then the subsequent warming and rising seas submerged the site, sealing it in a time capsule, preserving it for 140,000 years. So what does this all mean? It means the story of hominin evolution in Southeast Asia just got a whole lot more complicated and infinitely more exciting. No more simple tales of isolated groups evolving on their own and then just fading away. We need to think about interconnected populations, dynamic environments, and complex interactions. What if these sophisticated behaviors were widespread? What if encounters with other groups led to cultural exchange? What if this larger connected Sundanian population allowed Homo erectus to persist longer, overlap more with the first Homo sapiens arriving in the region? The idea of Homo erectus as an evolutionary dead end just doesn't fit this new picture. Sundaland may have been a vibrant crossroads, a far more dynamic stage for human evolution than we ever dared to dream. This single discovery, dredged from the seabed, hasn't just given us new fossils. It's given us a new lens through which to see our ancient past. And it leaves us with one profound, thrilling thought. What else is down there, waiting to rewrite history all over again? The deep holds more secrets, and the quest to uncover them has just begun.